This has been the goal from the very start. Going all the way back to April with stage one in China, everybody's had one eye on the target and the other eye on this prize, a ticket to the World Cup Finals in the Olympic capital of the world. As the planet's best archers hopscotched around the globe, competing in Shanghai, Medellin, Antalya, and Wrocław, the battle only intensified and got tighter in each of the four divisions. It was survival of the fittest, and the strong survived. Now, 32 of the best in the business have a shot at a September to remember here along the shores of breathtaking Lake Geneva. Wherever you happen to be watching, bienvenue, jin dobre, merhaba, hola, ni hao, bonjour, konnichiwa, grietzi, privyet, shalom, guten tag, ciao, annyeonghaseyo, good day mates, and welcome to Lausanne, Switzerland, home of the International Olympic Committee, and home once again for a second time to World Archery's World Cup Finals. You're looking live at this idyllic setting along Lac Léman, otherwise known as Lake Geneva, a setting we hope will truly inspire some tremendous competition again today in what has become the crown jewel of World Archery's outdoor season. Along with GBR's Hilda Gibson, I'm Carl Arkey, rolling out the red carpet here in the Alps for the Recurve quarterfinals. It is Recurve Sunday, and Hilda, we've got great conditions for scoring here today. It's a little bit overcast, but no real wind, and the temperature's absolutely perfect. I can't think of a better day to compete for these gold and bronze medals.
Absolutely. It's very calm, as you say. Yesterday we saw that too. There was no real variation in the wind. We're by a lake rather than by the sea, so that we didn't get any change of the air conditions during the day. More overcast today. Yesterday was very bright. Ideal conditions today.
You've been in the sport for 40 years. You know what this is like to go into competition like this at this kind of high level. There's got to be a lot of nerves, a lot of emotion, a lot of adrenaline flowing right now for these archers as we get set to go with the women.
Absolutely, and a key part of what they'll be doing is looking to control that and keep that under control, go out there and enjoy it. As you say, it's, you know, the adrenaline's flowing. A key part of their training is to how to control that and get to just the right arousal level for them and just treat this as another day out there shooting.
Tatiana Segina from the Russian Federation, 22 years old, the new European champion, taking the stage first. She is ninth in the world and eighth in the World Cup rankings with 25 World Cup points. We'll get into her story a little bit more, but first, let's introduce you to the young woman that she'll be competing against, the 23-year-old Korean Jung Dasomi, number two in the world and number two in the World Cup rankings with 37 points this summer, this season. She was number one back in 2012. Interesting, the Koreans decided to arrive, I believe it was either late Friday or yesterday, so they weren't here for the familiarization day. So this is really her first time out on this stage looking at this target, and it's always different from the warm-up area.
It is different from the warm-up area. There's a reasonable distance from the warm-up area that they've had to walk through to get to this range. So yes, she'll be the first time she's competing here in this range.
So we shall see how we progress in this match between the archer from the Russian Federation and the archer from Korea. Tatiana Segina, 22 years old, as we said. Tatiana got the invite to come to the finals when Zhu Hyun-jung of Korea dropped out. Segina could have clinched a spot in Poland by winning the bronze medal in stage four, but she lost that match to Deepika Kumari. However, she got a lifeline, she got a second chance, and here she is competing against this young woman, Jung Dasomi of Korea. Strong start.
Yes, and first time in the stadium doesn't cause any problems.
By the way, they are shooting from 70 meters away at a target face that's about 122 centimeters in diameter. The 10 ring, as you well know, Hilda, much, much smaller.
Yeah, about the size of a CD or a DVD.
And they're trying to hit that from 70 meters away. So Jung Dasomi in those center circles with her first two shots, as is Segina. There'll be five sets, three arrows per archer per set. A total of 15 shots, if need be, will go to a one-arrow shoot-off. Beautifully done by Zheng Dasomi. So three nines for Segena. She puts up a score of 27 points here in the first end. And the two set points will go to Zheng Dasomi. This is not cumulative scoring as we saw in compound archery yesterday.
No, yesterday the match winner is the person who has the highest score after 15 arrows. In the set system, there's three arrows per set. Each archer gets a score for those three arrows. The highest score wins the set and gets 2 points for the set. And it's the archer that gets to 6 points first for the match.
And you like this system. I mean, we were talking about this before we went on the air today, how the sport has progressed, and you like the format.
I love this system. It's great for the spectators. The matches are exciting. You're never sure until the very end of the match who's going to win. Makes a great spectacle.
And if you drop a set, as Tatiana Segena did just there, all is not lost. She has a chance to come back right here. If she wins this set, we're tied up at two apiece. Segena shooting first and shooting well. Tatiana Segena. Now Zheng Dasomi, who skipped stage one in Shanghai, but came up big with a gold medal victory in Medellin. That helped her get to the World Cup finals here in Lausanne. Both archers starting off with 10s on their first shots. Segena's drifting into the 9 ring on her second shot. Ooh, out in the red rings, in the red zone. So now the advantage goes to Tatiana Segena from the Russian Federation. And so she has essentially clinched this second set. A 10 right here by Zheng Dasomi will not be enough to catch Segena. So the 2 points will go to the archer from the Russian Federation, and we're tied up at two set points apiece. And again, I think, Hilda, that speaks to the beauty of this format, the fact that you can have one rough set, but still recover.
Absolutely. So if something untoward happens, then you can come back, as we've just seen. It's essentially all square now, and they start the third set on equal terms again.
I think it's always interesting to watch these first shots of any match. It's almost a feeling out sort of a period, trying to get a feel for where the wind is and how things shape up, the conditions out here.
That's one of the really big challenges of these sort of events, because it's all about consistency. And getting the feel of the venue, getting the feel of the conditions. Even if you've had the familiarization, that was a number of days ago. Today's a different day. The wind conditions are doing something different.
Beautiful, beautiful morning here in Lausanne, Switzerland. A little bit overcast, which is fine. But a light breeze. Temperature right around 70 degrees Fahrenheit. So ideal conditions on recurve Sunday in Switzerland. And almost an ideal shot by Zheng Dasomi. We are tied at two apiece. And the advantage in this third set goes to the Korean archer, who is up by 1 point in this set. Painting those center circles. Segena, a direct hit. So we're tied up at 19. Who will take this set and take the lead in the match?
Next.
Dead on. Now the pressure on Segena. Has to come up with a 10. If she does, she'll split the set points. And she does come up with a 10. That's a clutch shot.
Absolutely key shot under pressure. And now again, it's 3-each, so even terms going into the fourth set.
When they tie in the set, they'll split the set points. One goes to each archer, and so right now the score goes to 3-all after 3 sets. Just to tell you how these young ladies got here, Tatiana Segena started off the season in China, finished 17th, losing to Cheng Ming 6-4 in the 1/16th round, so she picked up no points there. Also picked up no points in Medellin, but she started to put things together in Antalya, acquired 10 points there. She got to the quarterfinals, where she finally lost to Zhu Yunzheng, and then she lost in the quarterfinals in Wrocław, Poland, to Ika Juliana Rahmawati of Indonesia, but acquired 15 points and then got a break when Zhu Yunzheng of Korea dropped out. So she got the lifeline. She's trying to make the most of it here in the quarterfinals on Recurve Sunday. Along with Hilda Gibson, I'm Carl Arkey, and we're glad to have you with us here on World Archery TV. Zhong to shoot first. Flying start. Second of matches her. Both these archers on top of their game, right from the get-go. Opportunity now for Segena. And takes full advantage. Jung Dosomi desperately needing a 10. Close. In fact, too close to call from our vantage point. We'll have to wait and see. But a 10 right here would give this set, and instead, it's out in the suburbs. It's in the sixth ring, and that means that Segena's got the blues. She had a chance to take that set and take the lead in this match, go up 5-3. Instead, she falls behind 5-3.
Absolutely, and that's the first arrow, you know, the first time that she's gone out of the middle, so real pressure shot there, and the Korean goes ahead.
So an opportunity gone by the wayside for Tatiana Segena, the Russian Federation. Had she shot a 10, she would have won the 2 set points, gone ahead 5-3. As it is, Dosomi wins the set, and she now has the lead 5-3. It's the first to 6 points that wins the match. And so right now, Tatiana Segena can ill afford to even split a set. She has to win from here on out and try to get to a shoot-off.
That's right, she has to win this set.
That's the start she needed. And again, too close to call from our vantage point. That will be a judge's call. Although they posted it as a 10. Tatiana Segena regaining her composure. Apparently that was a blip on the radar screen, the sixth that she shot. So once again, Segena with a chance to clinch the set. Easier said than done. Comes up with a 29. Now she's in danger because a 10 right here will win it for Zhong Dosomi. They would tie in the set, split the points. She would have 6, and that's all she needs to win this match. Oh, a 9.
Right now, it looks like New Zealand has shot 28 and New Zealand for 29. New Zealand winning that set outright and forcing the shoot-off.
So they are saying right now that she has 28 points. And it appears as though she has won the set, 29-28. So by the skin of her teeth, Hilda, she's able to get into a shoot-off right now. So our first match goes to a shoot-off.
Okay, and that's the wonders of this new system, and it allows Sagina now to have the opportunity in a single arrow shoot-off, get the arrow closest to the center, and win the match.
So Tatiana did what she had to do to get this to a shoot-off. Had Zheng Desomi shot a 10, this would all be over, but she did not. So now we go to the shoot-off. One arrow per archer, and the closest to the center takes the prize. And that's an opportunity to go to the semifinals this afternoon. Zheng Desomi, oh, very low and to the left. So here is the opportunity. The door wide open for Tatiana Segena, and she comes through with the winning shot. Much closer to the center of the target. Not dead center, but she didn't need to be.
No, when it mattered, she was able to put the arrow into the 10, very close to the center. Very high quality match, only two arrows in the whole of that match outside of the gold.
So a bit of an upset as our first match of the day goes to a shoot-off. And you would have to consider it an upset. Zheng Desomi came in ranked number two in the world, number two on the World Cup Tour as well, with 37 World Cup points. Tatiana Segena had only 25 World Cup points, was eighth in the World Cup standings, and ninth in the world standings. But she comes away and upsets the 23-year-old Korean Zheng Desomi. The highlight of the season for Zheng Desomi was her gold medal that she picked up in Medellin, the silver medal that she won in Medellin that helped her get to the World Cup final. But it is a short stay here in Lausanne, Switzerland for the Korean archer, as her shot in the shoot-offs was almost outside the 9 ring, almost wound up in the 8 ring. And Tatiana Segena, much, much closer to the center, able to score the victory in the shoot-off, 6-5, the final score. And Tatiana Segena will now move on to the semifinals this afternoon, and now has to play the waiting game to see whom she will face. Our next match featuring this young woman, Cheng Ming of China, 28 years old, sixth on the World Cup Tour and 10th in the world overall. Picked up 5 points in Shanghai, did not compete in Medellin. Got a silver medal in Antalya and Konialti Beach, lost in the gold medal match, 6-2 to Cheng Haijin, and then in Wrocław went out early, losing in a shoot-off. Here she'll face Elena Richter of Germany, 25 years old, sixth in the world and third on the World Cup Tour, picked up 35 points, most of those coming in Shanghai, where she won her quarterfinal match in a shoot-off, then won the semifinal match, and went on to win the gold medal, beating Zhu Jing of China 6-2. It was her first World Cup medal outdoors. We shall see Zhu Jing momentarily, the second of the two Chinese archers who qualified here for the World Cup finals. But first, Cheng Ming, who won the gold medal at the World Cup finals in Istanbul 3 years ago, 2011. On the grounds of the Küçüksu Palace in Istanbul along the Bosphorus. Here we are along the shores of beautiful Lake Geneva. The Alps in the background, and in the foreground, the field of play, as you get a bird's eye view here in Lausanne, Switzerland. Great coverage by our crew, Hit the Roof Productions. All brought to you by World Archery. So Elena Richter to shoot first.
Wow.
Just like our first match, Hilda, starts off with a good shot, tough shot.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's great for them to get out there and put the first shot in the middle.
Cheng Ming says, I'll see ya. Now Ellen Richter will say, I'll try to raise you. The onus back on Cheng Ming right now. In the red zone. So the advantage immediately goes to the German archer, Ellen Richter.
Nine.
There is a nine that clinches the set. It's out of reach for Cheng Ming. Even a 10 right here will leave her a point short. And the two set points will go to Elena Richter from Germany. So a strong start for Elena Richter. Talk about their styles a little bit, Hilda, as you watch their shooting.
I think one of the things to say about all the athletes you've seen so far is just how firm and clear their loose is when they let the string go. There's very much a follow through when they're loosing, as we call it. When they let go of the string, it's called a loose. Very, very, you can see the power in the shot from all of them.
I think it's interesting, too, that they've had this experience of being on this stage before. I think that's the beauty of the World Cup circuit, the fact that they do compete quite a bit in high-pressure situations for weeks at a time and go to these events. And so I think that has helped them progress. It's helped the sport progress.
Absolutely, yes. Having the World Cup series, having these finals at each event means that all of these competitors here are seasoned campaigners. They've been out there, they've experienced this before. So they're coming out and they're really looking to shoot every arrow the same and really get that consistency.
Higher performance level, better matches. As Cheng Ming starts off a little high, it leaks out into the nine ring. Richter leading 2-0 on set points. She's also left with her first shot. And back into that red zone again. Cheng Ming trying to get adjusted to her surroundings. Elena Richter, though, seems quite comfortable right now. While Cheng Ming does not appear to be so comfortable. Seems to be searching right now.
Those arrows definitely spreading a little.
For the set. And there it is. So she will take the set, 28-26, pick up two more set points. And right now, Cheng Ming is in danger of being swept as Elena Richter can run the table. If she wins the next set, this match is over. And Cheng Ming is fully aware of that fact. As we mentioned, Cheng Ming, the gold medalist at the World Cup Finals in Istanbul back in 2011. She also finished ninth at the London Olympics, which I know you participated in.
No, I didn't participate, and I was part of the organizing.
Organizing, in that sense, yes. And what a great event.
Fantastic event. It was just wonderful to be at Lourdes. Really iconic venue. We made it the home of archery for 2 weeks.
And we congratulate you on that. You and everybody else involved, staging a great, great Olympic competition. Cheng Ming trying to raise the level of her game. She's backed into the corner, has her back against the wall, but comes out firing.
10, 9, 8, 7.
And Richter in the red ring. A red ringer for Richter. So for the first time, Cheng Ming has the bit of the advantage right now. trying to stay calm and composed.
Так, семь,
ноль, Richter gets things straightened out on the second shot, but it might be too little, too late. And a nine right there has put this out of reach for Elena Richter. The set will go to Cheng Ming and we will play on, regardless of what Elena Richter is able to do right here on this shot. Is that kind of I hate to almost say it, a throwaway shot, a shot where you just try something to see what happens?
I think it would have been a shot to really get her composure back again. I can't imagine that was the plan to put it over there. She would have been wanted to get that back in the middle, give her confidence for the next end. Up until now, Elena's really not put a foot wrong, really not given her Chinese opponent any space. First time she gives her some space, Ming has taken advantage of it.
Elena Richter, by the way, won the field championships in 2012 in Val d'Isère and was 17th at the London Olympic Games. And once again, you get to see the shooting style of the two archers. Cheng Ming starting to warm up, starting to get more comfortable in her surroundings, and takes that third set to make the score 4-2 in favor of the German archer, Elena Richter. Ms. Cheng trailing, still shooting first. The sun's starting to break through here in Lausanne on a Sunday morning.
7, 6.
And things starting to heat up in a strangely different way. Elena Richter was so good in those first two sets and now having trouble finding the center ring.
8.
But for that matter, so is Cheng Ming. A 10 right here, and the Richter's back in business.
10, 9.
7, 6.
Wow, what could have changed so much?
I think it's the way Elena's shooting the arrows as opposed to the conditions. So I think it's a real challenge to shoot every arrow consistently over the full range of the sets. Although they're seasoned campaigners, it's still a real challenge to go out there and shoot every arrow the same.
Well, Cheng Ming is going to take this set, as Elena Richter can only post 22 points in that fourth set. She had a 4-0 lead moments ago, but has dropped the next two sets, or perhaps more accurately, we should say that Cheng Ming has won the next two sets, and she has come back. She was on the precipice. She was on the edge of going over, but she's able to salvage it and tie it up at 4-all right now. So what looked like it was going to be perhaps a blowout has turned into a very, very tight competitive match between Cheng Ming of China and Elena Richter of Germany. Waiting in the wings, yet to come, Maida Roman of Mexico and Lisa Unruh, another German archer. And then we'll see Zhu Jing of China taking on Natalie Dilin of Switzerland. Each country that hosts a World Cup Finals gets to provide one wild card archer in each of the four divisions, and Natalie Dilin will play the part of the wild card today. Richter back on track. That'll give her a big confidence boost. And Richter now with a 1-point lead in the set, trying to come back after dropping the last two sets. Oh, now a little bit of trouble. 7 seconds on the clock. Still has time to get the shot off, but she'll have to hurry. Let's it go with 2 seconds on the clock. Wow, what a job. Under the gun, huh?
Absolutely. She did well to get that away and get it into the nine.
So we're tied up here in the fifth set. 4-all. Final arrow.
Same.
Are we headed for a shoot-off? Or can somebody grab control of this match? Elena Richter in the red ring is in danger right now. Cheng Ming needs 7 to win. And Cheng Ming lets it fly, and there's the shot, and there is the victory. Cheng Ming comes back after dropping the first 2 sets to win the next 3 sets. And rescues, takes the victory from the jaws of defeat. And boy, is she relieved. She knew she was in trouble, but she was able to keep it together. Elena Richter ran into trouble over the final 3 sets, and it's a 6-4 win for Cheng Ming of China, who moves on to the semifinals. It's always surprising to see something like that, I think, Hilda, because an archer who comes out and shoots as well as Elena Richter did in those first 2 sets, you expect her to continue that, and then things go awry.
Absolutely, and so she did so well to start with, and then it started to crumble, and when it crumbled, she wasn't able to bring it back again. So your comment about she shot a 7 on the right and then shot a 7 on the left, and was that a trying something out? No, I don't think that was trying something out. That was actually, she wasn't able to pull it back then, and so it was all a bit crumbly after that.
And it snowballs, doesn't it, as things start to fall apart like that. Now you've got not just the physical aspect of it, you've got the mental aspect to deal with.
Physically, you could see her shots in actually, you know, very strong, sharp shots when she was hitting the 10, but slightly softer, slightly more hesitant when they were starting to move outside. And, you know, once that starts to happen, it's very hard to bring it back again.
Yes, and I imagine doubt starts to creep in. You start second-guessing, maybe thinking a little bit too much.
Absolutely, and her Chinese opponent was able, you know, maybe not to be shooting as well to start with, but was able to keep it more under control as she went through.
So and Cheng Ming, yes.
Yeah, and it's Elena has done so well this season. The Germans are really up their game. So I am a little surprised to see that that's what happened. But, you know, going out there, that's when it really counts.
And it does happen. It happens quite often in this sport. It's a difficult, difficult game. Aida Roman will attest to that. She's worked very hard to become one of the top archers in the world. Aida Roman, big smile on her face from Mexico. 5th on the World Cup Tour this year, 13th in the world standings. She was number 2 a year ago. Started off strong, winning a gold medal in Nîmes at the Indoor World Championships. Went to Shanghai, lost to Zhu Jing in the semifinals before winning a bronze medal. Picked up 18 points. Got 5 more points in Medellin, where she lost, interestingly enough, to this young woman, Lisa Unruh, in the 1/8 round. So let's talk about Lisa Unruh a little bit. 11th in the world, 4th on the World Cup Tour, acquired 31 points, most of them coming in Medellin, where she won the silver medal. Interesting to note that in Colombia, she won 3 shoot-offs on her way towards that silver medal. And that included shoot-off victories against Aida Roman, Zhu Yunzhang. She got to the finals and then was blanked by Zheng Desomi, 6-0. Desomi, by the way, moments ago, falling here in the quarterfinals on recurve Sunday, losing to Tatiana Segina of Russia. So here we go, our 3rd quarterfinal match of the morning. And it's Aida Roman of Mexico and Lisa Unruh of Germany. The German archer on target number 2, shooting first. She catch the line, Hilda?
No, that's a 9.
Up 8.
So right out of the gates, Aida Roman on target. On. Tied up 19-0 here in the first set. Once again, 5 sets per match, 3 arrows per, and that 3rd arrow for Unruh winds up being a 7. And you could see the disappointment as she spun away from the shooting line. She knew when she let it go, it was not going to land where she wanted it to. However, that being said, Aida Roman comes up with all she needs to take that first set. And she picks up 2 set points. And Aida Roman, who was feeling a little bit under the weather, looks good now. Saw her on Friday, though. She was really battling a cold. And, you know, I think a lot of people forget about that as they watch athletes. And they forget that we're going from different parts of the world to another part of the world and also changing climates. Quite a bit cooler here than it is in her homeland of Mexico. And so she was kind of battling a cold, but now she's in a battle with Lisa Unruh, and she's focused on that. But there is that human element that has to be dealt with, too.
Absolutely. It's a pretty grueling schedule, actually. If, you know, they're going around from one event to another. There's a lot of travel. You've got the recovery time to take from that, as well as getting all the training in, as well as then getting off and getting ready and prepared for the next event. So, yeah, there's a lot goes on in the background to get them onto that shooting line.
Jet lag, different diets, things of that nature to deal with. Pierre-Julien Deloche, who picked up a silver medal yesterday in men's compound, the Admiral, watching the action here in Lausanne on Sunday as Lisa Unruh gets back on track. Aida Roman leading in the match, 2-0. Dead center. X marks the spot for Aida Roman.
Good.
So the door cracked slightly open right now for the Mexican archer. Aida Roman, who was 7th in Paris last year at the World Cup Finals, hoping to improve upon that performance. And right now, she's tied up at 19-all here in the second set. So the pressure's on. Lisa Unruh has done her job. It'll take 10 to split the set.
10 to tie. He's 10.
Just what the doctor ordered.
Absolutely.
Forget about that cold. The doctor says, no, just a couple of 10s and you'll be fine. Is there a doctor out there who can write that prescription? You've been in the game for a while. Have you found this doctor yet? Yes. Go see the physician, say, I just need a couple of 10s, doc. That's all.
I think sometimes we need the physicians to help with injuries and recovery and so on, but unfortunately they're not able to write that prescription.
I have been so impressed this season watching Aida Roman and watching her after her shots, how she really gets within her own bubble, so to speak, and really just focuses inward on herself and isn't really aware of whatever else is going on around her.
Yeah, and you really need to be able to do that. You need to be out there. You're on a shooting line and there's a target. And the fact that this is the World Cup final should be away in the distance. It's you and the target. And the more that you're able to do that, the less likely it is that other things are going to creep in and start that uncertainty.
Aida Roman tied up with Lisa Unruh at 3, or excuse me, leading Lisa Unruh 3-1 as we begin the third set. Unruh trying to come from behind.
Open.
A little bit high on that shot. Last year, Lisa finishing in the top 10 in 7 of the 8 events at 3 of the 4 stages. So she has been a very consistent archer herself.
8.
Meanwhile, an unusual 8 for Roman.
Halte.
Unruh putting some more distance, perhaps, between herself and Aida Rahman in this set. So Rahman is vulnerable now. Unruh can clinch this set. But the eight provides a little suspense, a little drama, and you can see she's frustrated. Because now there's an opportunity for Aida Rahman. With a 10, she ties up the set. Ah, but she can't come up with the shot. Two eights in that set. And the set points go to Lisa Unruh, and we're tied up at 3-all.
Yeah, and that last shot wasn't quite so sharp. You can see as she released it, it wasn't quite such a neat to clear it loose.
So a psychological boost for Lisa Unruh of Germany. And Aida Rahman staying calm, cool, collected. Getting some words of advice from her coach. All the Mexican Arches, I'm sure, excited about the fact that next year's World Cup Finals will be in Mexico City. As will be the World Championships in 2017.
So, yep, I'm sure they're very excited about that. Mexico have really sort of exploded onto the scene, and really since London. And I'm sure they'll be very happy to welcome the world into Mexico.
Aida Rahman had a lot to do with that in London, where she almost won the gold medal at the Olympics in 2012, settled for the silver, losing a very tight match to Kibo Bae of Korea. Right now she's in a tight match, tied up with this woman, Lisa Unruh of Germany. It's 3-all as we head to the fourth set. And the eights have become contagious.
Nine.
1 point advantage for Rahman. Good shot by Lisa Unruh. By the way, that medal that Aida Rahman won in London was Mexico's first Olympic medal in the sport of archery. A significant moment in Mexican archery history. But that's all in the past right now. Here in the present, she's tied up in this set, tied up in the match, and needs a 10 to tie this set, split the set points, and take the score to 4-4. If not, Lisa Unruh goes up 5-3. And would have Aida Rahman on the ropes. And the set does go to Lisa Unruh. So we're seeing another comeback, perhaps in the making right here, as Lisa Unruh fell behind 2-0 after the first set, was down 3-1 after the second set, but has come back and won the next two sets and now leads it 5-3. It's interesting because earlier in the previous match, her teammate Elena Richter had a 4-0 lead and saw that evaporate as Cheng Ming was able to come back and win that match 6-4.
I think the thing is at this level, the set system, it really plays to the set system because the slightest flaw and your opponent can, you can be made to pay for it, and then the match swings from one side to the other. So that consistency is so important.
It does swing, and it swings quickly. It can change just like that in the blink of an eye. Aida Rahman got off to a good start, was leading 2-0, then up 3-1. But a shot here, a shot there, just a little bit off target. And right now, she's backed up against the wall, backed into a corner. So she gets to shoot first. Must win this set. And shows a sense of urgency with that shot. Chips are down. She comes through with a 10 to start off the set. Unruh drifts down into a red ringer. So now Roman with a very, very golden opportunity to take this set, and she's just about grabbed a hold of it. Back-to-back tens.
9, good.
So right now, all Aida Roman needs is 7 or better, and she takes this set and ties it up at 5 all.
9.
And there you go. She's done it. It's out of reach for Lisa Unruh. A 10 will only net her 26 points. So she comes up 3 points short in the set. And the 2 points do go to Aida Roman of Mexico. So we are tied at 5 all. We've had some great matches right off the get-go. Yeah. We might be, we are going to another shoot-off, yes. Second shoot-off so far today. We've had 3 matches, 2 of them going to shoot-offs. The first shoot-off went to Tatiana Segana of Russia as she defeated Korea's Jung Dosomi in a shoot-off 6-5. In the second match, it was Cheng Ming coming from behind to win in 5 sets 6-4. And now we head to the shoot-off. One arrow shoot-off closest to the center will determine the winner. And look at that slow motion. Interesting to watch the flight of those arrows.
Yeah. You see them poising down to the target. Yeah. I mean, that match is a really, really close match because it's been going each way. So it was one ahead, the other one, then it was evens, and then Unruh went ahead, and then Aida was able to really put those last 3 hours in and bring it even again.
All sorts of twists and turns.
Absolutely.
And momentum shifts in that match.
Just shows how closely matched these two are.
And it speaks to their mental strength, the way that they are able to recover and come back after disappointing shots and able to come up with big shots. And that's why we are going to the shoot-off. And because we are in a shoot-off, they'll remove the other target face that was basically Swiss cheese after the first 5 sets. All the holes left in that target. They need a perfect target face because it could come down to a very close call by the judge. Closest to the center will determine the outcome of this match between Mexico's Aida Roman and Germany's Lisa Unruh. So the fans on the edge of their seats here on the shore of Lake Geneva. On Recurve Sunday, beautiful Sunday morning.
We are now calibrating the Falco Eye laser system, and we will be commencing with a shoot-off momentarily.
And I would imagine one of the challenges here at this point is just keeping control of your emotions and your thoughts.
Yep, composing yourself, going out there, and then shooting your arrow. Shooting your arrows, as you know you can, as you know you want to. Again, get on the line, shoot on the target.
They've had a lot of time to think about it. So here we go. Each archer straddling that shooting line. And Lisa Unruh to shoot first, which some think is an advantage.
9.
We'll see how much of an advantage it is. She's not as happy with that shot as she wanted to be. You could tell. She comes away shaking her head. Aida Roman going for the win right here. Closest to the center will take it. And I believe she's taking it. Yes, she is closer to the center. And Aida Roman with a high five for her coach as Mexico advances to the semifinals. Mexico coming back. After falling behind 5-3, she won that 5th set, and she wins the shoot-off. And Lisa Unruh with a very, very strong performance, but not strong enough. So the 2 German archers are out of the competition at this point. We have the Russian Federation's Tatiana Segana. We have Cheng Ming of China. And now we have Mexico's Aida Roman advancing to the semifinals. Aida Roman winning 6-5 in the shoot-off.
So it was just a couple of centimetres that decided that match in the end. Very, very close match, very closely matched competitors.
And the mental strength of Aida Roman coming through as she was able to come up with the shot she had to have to win that shoot-off. Of course, she studies psychology. She's put her psychology studies on hold to focus on archery, and I don't blame her. She's shooting so well right now, the age of 26. But a student of psychology, and you can sort of tell that from the way she handles herself up there on the shooting line. Very, very strong mentally. And that may have made a difference in this match. Once again, the super slow motion. Getting to watch those arrows in flight as well as the release. And look at that smile. So on to our fourth quarterfinal match, our final quarterfinal match here on Recurve Sunday. And this is where we feature the wild card. And that would be Natalie Dielen of Switzerland. And Natalie Dielen, a very, very familiar face to those of us in world archery. Natalie joined the national team in 1999, has been ranked as high as 54th in the world. And we all know her as a Secretary General Tom Dielen's better half.
Indeed, yes.
Is that a nice way to put that?
Absolutely.
I don't think you'd take offense at that, do you?
Not at all.
So Natalie out there, Natalie, of course, works behind the scenes a great deal with World Archery, helping out wherever needed to conduct events all around the world. And now she gets to go out on this platform and on this stage and compete against the number one woman in recurve archery in the world, and that is China's Zhu Jing. Zhu Jing, number one in the world and number one on the World Cup Tour. She amassed 47 World Cup points this year. 23 years old, will turn 24 in 2 days. And she's hoping to take flight towards a gold medal here at the World Cup final. She's had a great summer, but it's been a little bit frustrating for Zhu Jing. She's had two chances to win gold medals, and each time she wound up with silver. Settled for silver in Shanghai at stage one, where she lost to Elnora Richter. And then in Poland, she lost to Indonesia's Ika Juliana Rachmawari and settled for the silver in Wrocław as well.
Natalie.
Zhu Jing, hoping to start her run towards a gold medal here. If she is going to win that gold medal, she'll have to win three matches today. The quarterfinal match this morning, the semifinals this afternoon, followed by the medal matches. Bronze and gold. So here is Natalie Dielen. Now on the World Archery website, Natalie is known as the Terminator. Are you familiar with that, Hilda?
No, I wasn't either.
I'm not sure if Tom Dielen put that on there. But Natalie, all business, serious about this, and thinks she has a chance. And you have to believe that. What a shot for Natalie Dielen to start off. There's a big confidence boost for her. Zhu Jing, 23 years old, and falls behind here in the first set. Natalie this summer competed in Shanghai, Medellin, Antalya, Poland. And that one ends up in the red zone. She seemed to be a little bit shaky holding that shot. But Zhu Jing not much better. Zhu Jing with a pair of nines to start off. Dielen hoping to pick up a dime right here. And she does, a 10. Natalie enjoying that shot. Puts a little bit of pressure on Zhu Jing, and Zhu Jing with the nine. And how about that? They split the first set.
That's great stuff.
Our judge is going to have to
Natalie's the wild card, but Natalie's a three-time Olympian. She has shot at this level for some considerable time. And she's in her home city. As you say, all of those other things that go with being, traveling around the world, it's a very different environment from China, but Natalie's in her own home environment in Switzerland. So all those things can count in favor.
She still practices with and competes with the Lausanne Archery Club. Very much involved in the sport as a shooter and working behind the scenes as well. So Natalie Dielen coming out and dealing with Zhu Jing in that first set. They split the set points. It's tied up at one apiece. As we head toward the second set with Zhu Jing. Zhu Jing sets the bar high here in the second set.
Eight.
Was it full draw for quite some time?
Yeah, a bit of uncertainty creeping in there, I think.
Zhu Jing smoothly draws it back. Releases, splash, another 10. Well done by Natalie Dielen. So this is out of reach for Natalie Dielen, but she will still try to shoot as strong a shot as she possibly can. The two set points will go to well, apparently the first set went to Natalie Dielen. I stand corrected. I thought they had split. Apparently Natalie had won the first set. And Zhu Jing takes the second set.
Oh la la, bonjour.
Math was never my strong suit, Hilda. Apparently, obviously.
I thought it'd been a draw from the one of the arrows missed in golf.
Yes, there must have been a change in the scoring, and they just forgot to tell us. It happens from time to time. And upsets also happen from time to time. I can remember 2 years ago in Tokyo, the wild card, Honda, I believe it was Honda Yumiko, pulled off a first round quarterfinal upset in Tokyo. So it can happen. We've seen it.
I was going to say, it can happen. It does happen.
And Natalie Dielen knows that. She was in Tokyo. She saw it that day. And she's not out here to just go through the motions. She's trying her best. Although that shot ends up in the suburbs. She wanted to be downtown, which is where Zhu Jing has planted that shot. Dielen draws it back and scores an 8. But she is at the mercy of Zhu Jing right now. And she is showing no mercy. Great grouping here in this third set for Zhu Jing of China, number one in the world. Facing the wild card from Switzerland, Natalie Dielen. So a tougher set for Natalie Dielen, who won the first set, led 2-0, dropped the second set, and now will drop the third set as Zhu Jing goes through the formalities. And right now, she's getting into her groove. finding her rhythm, feeling good about herself. Zhu Jing is a very emotional archer, as I've watched her during this season, and can ride that roller coaster.
And that's what you need to be able to do. So when you come out and things don't quite go according to plan to start with, you need to be able to just dig in there and go on to the next set, go on to the next set. Clearly she's found her groove here.
She's gotten into the sweet spot here in the third set, which she takes to grab a 4-2 lead in the match. But three tens, 10-10-10, right across the board for Zhu Jing. Now, I was trying to convince Secretary General Tom Dillon that he should be out here shooting here today, at the very least in the mixed teams. He and Natalie should work together. He didn't think that was such a good idea.
Well, he does still shoot. He shoots very regularly, I understand.
Yes.
So, yeah, he's out there at the club very regularly, practicing archer.
Each of them says the other one is better. I think that's the key to a good marriage in archery. Natalie Dillon down by two, shooting first here in the fourth set. I'm Carl Arkey along with Hilda Gibson from the GBR. Or I should say GBR.
Nine or ten.
Very little drop off for Zhu Jing after that third set. Right around the center of that target. And as a motorcycle guns it in the background, Natalie Dillon will have to try to focus, block all that sound out, and shoots a pretty good shot. She's grouped well, just a little bit left of where she'd rather be. Unofficially, we are tied at 18 all here in the fourth set. That first arrow by Zhu Jing. A little bit of a question mark right now. So a less than accurate eight for Natalie Dillon leaves her vulnerable. And a nine will win the match for Zhu Jing, and it is over. Turn out the lights. Zhu Jing comes through with a nine that she needed to wrap it up and close out the match with Natalie Dillon. But Natalie put up a good fight, performed well, and made Zhu Jing work for it. Natalie winning the first set. And then Zhu Jing took the next three and wins the match by the final score of 6-2-2. So Zhu Jing, in pursuit of the elusive gold medal, as we said at the start of the match, she has really had a good summer. She won the silver medal in Shanghai, won a silver medal in Wrocław, was ninth in Antalya, went out in the 1/8 round there on Konialty Beach, but did pick up 5 points. Didn't compete in Medellin, but has had a good summer, but just hasn't been able to get that gold medal. That's what she's after here today, obviously, along with Aida Roman and Cheng Ming and Tatiana Segana, all of whom will now advance to the semifinals this afternoon.
Absolutely, and let's see if that's that elusive gold medal can come her way. Just a comment from, you know, having seen the last three matches, I think that emphasizes just what a high quality match the first match was. In that first match, there were only two arrows in the whole match outside of the goal, outside of the yellow part of the target. And very, very high quality match, that first one.
That first match between Tatiana Segana of the Russian Federation and Jung Dasumi of Korea. And in that match, Tatiana Segana took the first set. He was tied after the second set, tied after the third set. Jung Dasumi took a 5-3 lead in the fourth set, only to see Segana come back, win the fifth set, tie the match at 5-5. And then the Russian archer able to win the shoot-off and win the match 6-5. Now a little bit more of the Swiss culture as the Alpine horns entertain the crowd here along the shores of Lake Geneva. Along with Great Britain's Hilda Gibson, I'm Carl Arkey. I hope you're enjoying the taste of the Swiss culture here, the Alpine horns, and of course the Swiss flag being flown here on the field of play in Lausanne, Switzerland, home of the International Olympic Committee, and a wonderful spot to come and vacation and to visit, just a marvelous, marvelous city. Of course, obviously the home of the Olympic Museum, which I have yet to get a chance to go and see, but I've heard nothing but rave reviews about that museum, Hilda.
I've been lucky enough to go to it this summer, actually. Yeah, it's great. It's just been all refurbished, so it's newly appointed. It's great. It tells the whole history of the Olympic movement, and there's lots and lots of sport memorabilia there as well. Certainly worth a visit.
And the same goes for just about all of Switzerland. What a beautiful, beautiful country. And we want to thank everybody, the organizing committee and everybody here for the great hospitality. It has been a wonderful weekend so far, and it's only getting better, I think, as the gentleman now takes center stage. Jake Kaminski of the United States getting a chance to come to the World Cup Finals. He qualified when Lee Sung-yung of Korea declined the invitation, decided not to come, and so they plucked up Jake Kaminski, gave him a call, and Jake said, yeah, I don't have anything on my calendar for that weekend. I think I'll come on over. Jake, happy to be here. He's got his wife with him. She's in the coach's box, I believe, today, and able to involve the family in the situation. And he will be facing the youngest competitor ever in a World Cup final, the 16-year-old sensation from Brazil, Marcos Vinicius de Almeida, number 2 on the World Cup Tour and 10th in the world. Jake Kaminski, 15th in the world and 11th, or I should say 8th on the World Cup circuit this summer. So this should be an interesting match between the veteran, Jake Kaminski, veteran, 26 years old, but he's been around for quite a while, and has quite the resume, as we'll get into that during the course of this match. Marcos de Almeida acquiring quite the resume himself at the age of 16, and obviously he's pointing towards Rio in 2016, wanting to shoot and represent Brazil in his home country right now, hoping to get into the hunt for a gold medal here in the World Cup Finals in Lausanne.
9-1.
D'Almeida.
Got this, babe.
Dials up a 9.
10.
Jake awesome. Kaminski in his 8th year out here on the World Cup Tour. Marcos D'Almeida has been shooting juniors primarily. Just starting to get his feet wet. And he think he got both feet in on that shot.
9. No.
Strong shots, baby. Got this.
8-3.
Okay. Opportunity already for Jake Kaminski.
7.
Ooh, but the 7. And that gives the set to Marcos de Almeida. So de Almeida forges ahead in the match as he takes the first set and takes a 2-0 lead. Jake Kaminski of the USA failed to pick up points in Shanghai at stage 1, went to Medellin, lost to Ogeniek in the quarterfinals, but acquired 11 points, then went to Antalya again, lost, but this was to Furukawa Takahuru, picked up 5 points for his efforts, and then he faced Marcos Vinicius de Almeida at stage 4 in Wrocław, Poland. Lost 6-0 in the quarterfinals there, acquired 11 more points. And all of those points were important because when Lee Sung-yung decided that he was not going to attend the World Cup Finals, it put Jake Kaminski right there. He was next in line. And he'll start off the second set, struggling a little bit and trying to adjust. Meanwhile, the 16-year-old from Brazil, pretty cool customer for a 16-year-old.
He's had such an amazing year. He's done so well at the World Cups and then the Youth Olympic Games. And now he's here, all in one year.
De Almeida, the silver medalist at the Youth Olympic Games in Nanjing this summer. We'll talk about that a little bit more later on, but really coming out, shooting well. Back-to-back tens here in the second set, which he is poised to take. Now, Jake Kaminsky making it a little tougher for him, but eight or better gives two more points to Marcus Vinicius De Almeida. And there it is. He takes the set, and he's got a stranglehold on this match. Just like that, comes right out of the box and goes up 4-0 in this quarterfinal match against Jake Kaminsky of the United States. Getting back to Marcus De Almeida, at those Youth Olympic Games in Nanjing, he lost to Korea's Lee Woo-suk, who shot a new world record in the 60-meter qualification round and then missed on only two arrows. Just two arrows in the gold medal match. That's pretty tough to beat.
That's very tough to beat.
When somebody else is shooting that well, sometimes I think you just have to say, Hilda, it's their day.
It sounds like it definitely was his day. And they're shooting at 60 meters, so that's 10 meters closer than these guys are shooting now, but that's still some shooting. That's very, very impressive.
And it was an impressive performance by the Korean archer as well as Marcus De Almeida, who also won three titles at the South American Games in Chile this year. His track record this summer, he had three ninth-place finishes at Shanghai, where he lost to Pierre Plion, who we'll see momentarily. Jake Kaminsky starting off strong here in the third set. Needs to start off strong and stay strong to get back into this match. Now De Almeida. A tall, rangy young man, 16 years old, but he's about 6'2", maybe even 6'3". Very athletic. Jake Kaminsky showing the form that helped him win a team silver medal at the London Olympics back in 2012. So the advantage now goes to Kaminsky here in this third set. Jake trying to turn things around, but leaves things open right now. A 10 by De Almeida will win it. De Almeida, a direct hit. De Almeida comes through and sweeps Jake Kaminsky, who had a chance to extend this match, but couldn't come up with quite the shot he needed on his third attempt here in the third set. And so Marcus De Almeida, who swept Jake Kaminsky at stage four in the Wrocław, Poland last month, does it again here in Switzerland in the quarterfinals.
Amazing, amazing. I mean, Jake's last shot there, I think he just gave it a little bit too much, maybe sort of just wanting too much of it to go well. But Almeida just, you know, De Almeida just got on there and did the business.
Youth will be served. Sometimes I think, and maybe we saw this even yesterday with Bridger Deaton, you put these young guys in these situations, and I'm not sure that they know that they're supposed to feel pressure, that they're supposed to not win. They haven't been around long enough to do this. They don't know any better. They go out and they just shoot great.
Absolutely, that could be part of it. De Almeida's now, I mean, he's done the four World Cups this year and he's done the Youth Olympic Games, so, you know, he's actually, I think perhaps some of it is they're young, they get used to it. This is normal.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't extra pressure. This is just normal.
This is what they've come to know. Go out, shoot tens, go back, rest up, get ready for the semifinals. So unfortunately for Jake Kaminsky, his day is done quickly, but on the other hand, for Marcus De Almeida, it's another big win, another notch for him. He notches up a 6-0 win and now moves on to the semifinals, which is what Pierre Plion is hoping to do as he takes the stage and is introduced here. And a lot of fans from France, a lot of fans here in Switzerland getting behind Pierre Plion. Pierre Plion of France. What an interesting young man. It's kind of fun. I rode Metro from the hotel down here to the Ouchy district, which is where we are located here. And Pierre was on the Metro with me, and two young people took a look at him, said, "Who are you?" And he said, "I am Pierre Plion." And they said, "Great, we're going to the archery match today. We're going to cheer for you. We've just picked you out, and you're our guy. He said, thank you very much. Merci beaucoup. He'll need the moral support as he takes on Florian Kalund of Germany. Kalun, fourth in the world and sixth on the World Cup circuit this season, 21 years old, and his shining moment came on the beach in Antalya, Turkey. Won the gold medal there, defeated Korea's Lee Sung-young in the 1/8 round before facing Koo Bun-chan in the finals. Had to use his spare bow late in the match to finish things off and win. And we'll get into that a little bit more as this match progresses. But Florian Kalund, it was that victory in Antalya that propelled him here to the World Cup finals in Lausanne. As for Pierre Pliant, his silver medal performance in Shanghai was instrumental in getting him here to Lausanne. Pierre, fifth in the world and third in World Cup points this summer with 36.
Ouais, c'est bien, Pierre.
On the line, should be a 10.
Allez, neutre, tout de suite.
So Pierre puts up what we think is a 10 on his first shot and comes back with a 9.
Mais encore un peu à droite comme à l'entraînement, Pierre. Tu mets un petit...
Those camera angles can be a little bit deceiving. We'll have to wait for the judge's ruling.
Nach links drehen.
Allez, tout falters. 5 seconds left on the clock when he released it, and there's the result. After this shot by Kalund, I want you to tell me what happened there. So it would appear, now we'll have to wait and see if that 9 is really a 10 for Pierre Pliant, but on his third shot, what happened?
So he either it came through the click or he almost shot it, realized that he wasn't ready. And then he was going to come down, but then he realized he didn't have time to come down and start again. So then he pulled back up again and got himself as good as he could and shot it. He got an 8. And I think, the arrow came off the arrow rest and he had to put it back on again.
And let's give it up for Florian Kalund.
Now, according to the scores that I'm receiving, they are giving 27 points to Kalund. And I think they gave 10 points to Pierre Pliant on his first shot, which would have given him 27 points. So I think they split.
I think that's right.
So it's one all, according to Hilda Gibson. Send those cards and letters to Hilda Gibson, GBR.
Allez, Pierre, tout de suite.
See, I give you all of that responsibility, and I take none of it for myself.
That's very kind.
I do that with all my guest analysts, just to make them feel a little bit more comfortable. Good to have Hilda with us here on Recurve Sunday, quarterfinals. And Kalund up 9-7 on his second shot. Pierre Pliant, after a 7, comes back with a 9. But right now, Kalund just needs to be solid. Not as solid as he wants to be. Only a 1-point lead heading to the final shot of this second end. Pliant places it in the 8 ring. Not happy at all. And I think he's going to be less happy after this shot by Florian Kalund, because he takes the set with that shot, picks up the 2 points, and now leads 3-2-1. I do want to get back to the story about his gold medal performance on Coney Alde Beach in Antalya. I mentioned he had to use his spare bow. His arrow rest had broken on the second shot during the match. I believe it was on the second shot of a, I believe it was the second to last set, as I recall. He got to the shoot-off won the gold medal as Kubanchan shot a 9, Florian shot a 10, and afterwards, Kaloon said he was aiming at the blue rings and it wound up in the center. Now, when I aim at the blue rings, they wind up in the blue rings or somewhere off in outer space. He aims at the blue rings and ends up in the center.
Well, sometimes you have to aim off, and sometimes you have to let your instinct say what you've got to do. So.
Pierre Plion, one of the event organizers of the Indoor World Championships in Nîmes. Here in the World Cup Finals, battling for his life, trailing 3-1 as we start this third set. Well done. And that brings a big cheer from the crowd in the grandstands here in Lausanne. Just waiting for something good to happen, something that they can cheer for the Frenchman. And the Frenchman with an opportunity here to put this set away. Is 9 enough? Is 9 enough? It is indeed. As Florian Kaloon comes up with an 8. And so we are tied up at 3-all.
So Plion did very well to get to draw the first set. He could have run out of time or actually not got a good enough score for that Mastaro. So he did really well. But I think in the next set that unsettled him. But I think now he's got it back.
Pierre Plion, a really very interesting story, as I mentioned, an organizer of the Indoor World Championships in Nîmes, and they do a great job in Nîmes with that event. Shanghai Stage 1 marked the first time he had entered and competed in a tournament on this level, and he says, I was so nervous, my legs were shaking, I couldn't shoot under those conditions. He still was able to come up with a silver medal performance, losing to Japan's Kikuchi Hideki. But along the way had defeated archers like Taylor Wirth and Juan René Serrano. So he proved his mettle in winning that silver medal. Could kind of tell by the way he pulled his bow away after that shot. He wasn't happy. So that's how it's going to be, a battle of eights. Pierre wants to pick up his game right here. Picks it up, lays it down, stabs the target with the 10. Advantage once again to Pierre Plion. What will he do with it? Pretty good shot. Is it enough? A 10 right here. They'll split the points in the set, and it'll go to 4-4. Anything less than 10? Oh, there is the 10. A clutch shot for the German archer, Florian Kaloon. So they split the points, and it goes to 4-4. So after the first men's quarterfinal match is decided in a sweep by Marcus Vinicius de Almeida of Brazil, this set going to go the distance. Heading to the fifth set right now between Pierre Plion of France and Florian Kaloon of Germany. Kaloon, 21 years old. Pierre Plion, not much older.
Hi, Pierre.
Once again, a great look, courtesy of super slow motion, at the flight of those arrows, the trajectory, how those arrows fishtail.
They bend as well as rotate as they leave the bow.
Speaking of arrows, good to see Greg Easton here for the World Cup Finals.
Yeah, he was watching all day yesterday. So.
Many of these archers using Easton and Hoyt bows as well. Leon with the early edge, but may have given it back with that eight. It's a chance for Florian Kalund.
Allez, Pierre. Actif et jusqu'au bout.
A 10 right here. He'll clinch the set. Instead, way high.
It's a really snatched shot.
So a 9 for Florian Kalund, and he moves on to the semifinals. And is it on the line? It appears to be on the line. Those shadows make it tough to see, but
I think that was in, into the 9.
All right, if Hilda Gibson says so, I'm going with that.
Let's wait and see what the judge says.
Apparently, Pierre Plion will concede the victory to Florian Kalund. So Kalund just did catch that line, apparently, and he will move on to the semifinals, and he is apparently our winner here in the second quarterfinal match of the day. But a nice round of applause for the Frenchman, Pierre Plion, who had a very good outdoor season. Very nice young man, very pleasant. And Pierre Plion's day is done. But more work to be done by Florian Kalund. Well, now we'll go back, reset, regroup, and get ready for the semifinals coming up this afternoon. Of course, we'll have that for you on World Archery TV as well. Along with Hilda Gibson from Great Britain, I'm Carl Arkey from the United States. And wherever in the world you are, whatever time of day it is in the world where you are located, we are certainly glad to have you with us, whether it's midnight, 4 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the afternoon. We are always glad to have our fans following on World Archery TV as we bring you the best in the business. Dr. Professor Erdner, the president of World Archery, on hand here in Lausanne, Switzerland. Our congratulations to him for a great year, and also on being named a member of the IOC. He'll be spending a little bit of time here in Lausanne, I imagine.
I would imagine he will, yeah. He's he's now on the IOC executive, so, yep.
Now here's the match I think a lot of people have been waiting for. The marquee matchup between Brady Ellison of the United States and Oh Jin Yek of Korea. Brady, match play this year, 23-4. In head-to-head competition, the two are tied up 1-1. But these two have been going at it for a number of years now. Brady, 5th on the World Cup circuit this summer and 6th in the world. Of course, he was number 1 in the world a year ago. Brady Ellison taking on Oh Jin Yek of Korea. Number 2 in the world and number 4 on the World Cup circuit. Actually, both of them have 34 points in World Cup play this year. So there's a good look at Oh Jin Yek. Oh Jin Yek, of course, the Olympic champion from 2012. The first Olympic medal for a Korean male archer. So he is a superstar back in his home country. Speaking of the IOC, his biggest dream, he says, in life is to become a member of the IOC. I think that's something to aspire to for all of us. Yes. You have to aim high.
I'd suggest that Mr. O has more chance than either of us.
Probably so. I will go to the Olympic Museum. That may be as close as I come. But this should be a great one. Two of the greatest who have ever picked up the recurve bow. Brady Ellison of the United States and Oh Jin Yek of Korea. They know each other so well, have battled against each other down through the years. And Oh Jin Yek to shoot first on target number 2, and he does what he does so often and does so well. Starts off with a 10. Sets the bar high for Brady,
right,
and Brady matches it.
Now you're rolling now.
So game on. Ellison and Oh. One more time.
Oh.
Back-to-back tens.
Yeah.
Just outside the 10 ring. So an opportunity now for Brady Ellison to tie this set, split the points. But easier said than done. Has to come through with a 10 on this third shot, and it's not close. So the set will go to Oh Jin-yek from Korea. He'll take a 2-0 lead in this showdown between two of the best in the business. Hilda, I want to get your thoughts on Oh's shooting style. A lot of people have weighed in on that and have their opinion of that. It's not necessarily a classical style, is it?
It's not conventional, but it very much works for him. So, you know, if it's about doing the same thing consistently every time. And, you know, classical is to maximize the chance of that happening, but you know, everybody has a different body shape and so on, and you know, this clearly works for him, but it's not necessarily what you would aim to teach somebody.
What's different about Oh Jin-yek? What stands out to you?
He looks sort of hunched up at his shoulders, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So if you so he doesn't look as though he's really opened out. Let's take a look this next time.
Back to the action. Crispin Duenas, by the way, of Canada. The announcer here in the venue, along with my good friend Mark from France, doing the French public address announcing.
Okay, nice strong shot, everybody. You got
a surprising
there.
8 from Oh Jin-yek.
Right at the sighting area.
But Brady Ellison in the red zone as well. Looking down at that target 70 meters away and trying to think of the adjustment that he needs to make on his next shot. Oh has already thought it over. Releases. And it touches down in the 9 ring. All here in the second set.
10.
Brady trying to apply the pressure and the 9.
Yeah, we'll just speed up a little bit. You'll be all right. We'll just pick it up a little bit more.
Creates an opportunity for Oh Jin-yek. A 10 here, and he'll take the second set and build himself a 4-0 lead. Which is exactly what the script called for Oh Jin-yek. As you watch Oh Jin-yek, you see no emotion, you see no, he's the same placid person, no matter what shot he shoots, what score he gets, nothing seems to faze him one way or the other.
And I think that's a real strength, and I think that's what you see from the vast majority of the Koreans, is very limited emotion, go on there, do the business, come away. I think they're very, very, the culture is very calm. And I think that comes through when you watch them shoot.
Right now, Oh Jin-yek taking care of business. He leads 4-0, winning the first 2 sets. Oh Jin-yek, 3 medals in Medellin this summer. A pair of golds in team events, settled for the silver medal individually. Went on to Antalya. Suffered a 6-4 loss to Furukawa Takahuru to finish 5th place, but picked up 13 points. The 13 points he got in Antalya, along with the 21 points in Medellin, qualified him for the World Cup final, where he's facing Brady Ellison, who had 2 team medals this summer, but no individual World Cup medals in 2014. Came to Switzerland hoping to change that, but he's going to have to battle back if he's going to change his script. Shot a 9 on his first shot, a 9 on the second shot. Trying to mine for gold, but hard to find that vein. Under 10 seconds on the clock for Oh Jin-yek. Looked like he's trying to pull it back in. A 10 would dial up the heat on Ocean Yak, and that's what Brady Ellison has just done. Of course, it's tough to get under this guy's skin. He lines up the shot, puts the laser lock on, and oh, it's a 9. So we will play on. Brady Ellison takes the third set. And now trails 4-2 in the match and has life. He needed that.
He did. He did need that.
Brady, of course, a bronze medalist in Paris last year at the World Cup final. In the shadow of La Tour Eiffel, 2012, he was the silver medalist at the World Cup final in Tokyo. Also won a team silver medal in the Olympic Games. And 3 years ago, he was almost unbeatable. Won 3 stages on the World Cup tour and won the gold medal at the World Cup final in Istanbul. But the competition has only gotten tougher as the years have gone by, as there's Rio Wild in the front row. I guess if you're Rio Wild, you get to sit in the front row. You get front row seats. Ellison still down, trailing in the match, so he'll shoot first.
There you go.
It's in that center circle.
Keep that aiming spot now.
Calmly, coolly releases, and it's a 9. So Ocean Yek falling behind here in the fourth set.
Yep,
Brady
right there.
Ellison
there you go, bud. One more.
Tacks on another 10. And all of a sudden, Ocean Yek having a little trouble locating the center of that target.
Right there.
Brady Ellison in the sweet spot, in the zone. 3 straight tens, takes the set. And the match is all tied up at 4 apiece now. Ocean Yek going through the formality of taking his final shot of this set. So it's 3 nines for him, but more significantly, Brady Ellison raising the level of his game as you turn up the pressure. He's come back from a 4-0 deficit, tied the match at 4-all right now. 2 of the very best in the world.
Yeah, and I guess Brady realizes that that's the sort of level he's got to shoot at if he's going to win the match. These two are really top-level competitors. So it's,
and you can see that target face, all those holes in it, looks like Swiss cheese.
How is everyone doing out there in that hot sun? Are you good?
Brady putting 3 holes right in the middle of that target on those last 3 shots. Putting himself right back in the match.
One shot at a time, all you got to do.
He was backed into the corner. But went to work. And now he's back in business. As we head to the 5th set, could we be headed for a shoot-off? The next 3 shots will tell the story. Ocean Yek to shoot first over on target number 2. With the boat horns blasting in the background, he blasts a 9. Door slightly open for Brady Ellison of the USA, but he comes up with a 9 as well. Each archer focused on what they've got to do. Not watching the other. And again, Ocean Yek. Presenting Brady with the opportunity, and he takes advantage. It appears to be on the line. Looks like he just caught it. Just was able to bite that line. They'll put the asterisk by it, but it looks like a 10. Unofficially, we're still tied at 18-all. Now there's Ocean Yek. doing what we've seen him do so many, many times before. Now a 10 right here and possibly, oh, it's a 9. So right now, we have to hold our breath a little bit, Hilda.
See if that second arrow is
indeed a 10. A lot's riding on it right now. If it is a 10, then they'll split the points and it's 5-all. We'll go to a shoot-off. So it comes down now to the judge. You be the judge, Hilda. What do you think? I know it's tough to tell. Somebody walked right in front of the camera.
Really close.
We are going to a shoot-off. They roll it a 10, and Brady Ellison, by the skin of his teeth, is able to keep this going. Brady looks over to O, gives him a nod, and says, all right, game on, big fella, let's go. And O's up for it. O loves it. He enjoys it.
I mean, now it's
Mr.
Like,
O.
Right now, the hole. She'll
the big O.
Holes in there.
You know. The Olympic champion from 2012. Won a silver medal at Belek, the World Championships last year. Of course, won the World Cup final in Paris last year after surviving an early scare from Gaël Prévost. In 2013, Ogeniec, a total of 8 World Cup medals. Had an incredible year. Was also the silver medalist at the World Championships in Torino back in 2011. So now he'll put all of his years of experience, and Brady will put all his years of experience to the best use possible here on this one arrow shoot-off. Again, closest to the center, and what is this, our third shoot-off of the day, I believe?
Yep.
Yep, third shoot-off of the day.
Two in the ladies, and this is the first one.
Earlier today in the women's recurve quarterfinal match, Tatiana Segana won a shoot-off with Zheng Dasomi. And that was followed by a shoot-off between Aida Roman and Lisa Unruh of Germany. Aida Roman winning that shoot-off and the match 6-5. Now we go to the one-arrow shoot-off right here. We're tied at 5-all after 5 sets. So one shot, winner take all. Closest to the center. So the crowd rising to the occasion on the edge of their seats. I'm sure a few folks back home in Korea and the United States on the edge of their seats watching this on World Archery TV. O to go first, which may be a little bit of an advantage. Steady on the shot in the 10 ring. So it not only has to be a 10, it has to be a really, really good 10, closer to the center. Brady for the win. Oh, it's very close. It looks like it might be
set. I think it's closer.
I think it's closer too. And Brady Ellison believes it's closer. Fired up. What a comeback for Brady Ellison of the United States as he comes from behind, down 4-0 in the match, forces a shoot-off, and then after Rowe puts up a 10, he goes a little bit better.
Good job.
Big hug from Mel, his coach, and a big sigh of relief.
That was always going to be a really big match. And
boy, it lived
Brady,
up to its advanced billing,
Brady
didn't it?
Turned it back again with those 3 10s. When he was 4-2 down, and then they were pretty, you know, beyond that, they were pretty close, but Brady just got it to the end.
What a gutsy, gutty performance by Brady Ellison of the United States. As we said at the beginning of this match, he has yet to win an individual medal this summer in World Cup play, but he's got a chance now, still has a chance to get that done here in Lausanne, Switzerland, as he moves on to the semifinals this afternoon. No guarantee, but at least he's got a chance. And it's probably just, what, centimeters difference?
Oh, again, absolutely. Maybe, you know, between 1 and 2. I mean, that was very close. That was very, very close.
And look at the reaction from Brady Ellison. Number 1 in the world a year ago. Has been at the top of the rankings for years and considered to be perhaps the best male archer in recurve archery in U.S. history. And comes through. Well, the pressure was dialed up the most. And wins the shoot-off with Ojin Yek. The big marquee matchup. How do you follow that up? Well, you follow it up with the number one archer in the world taking on the wild card from Switzerland, and that is Adrian Faber, who is very happy to be here. Big smile on his face. 19 years old, youngster from Switzerland, ranked 172nd in the world. This is his third year competing internationally. And of course, the hometown crowd giving him a big round of applause, trying to give him a little bit of a morale boost, which he will need as he will face the number one man in recurve archery, and that is Rick van der Ven from the Netherlands. Rick, number one in the World Cup circuit this year with 56 points, and number three in the world. So there's a good look at Rick van der Ven. We'll give you the rundown on him. On the national team since 2010. This year in match play, has lost only 4 of his 26 matches. Not bad. And he's coached by Ron van der Hoff. As you get a bird's eye view of the action here in Lausanne, Switzerland on a Sunday morning. Great crowd on hand. The only way to fly.
Absolutely.
Rick van der Ven's first arrow about to take flight. Looks like it's outside the line. But I always check with Hilda Gibson just to make sure.
I think that one's just out.
Faber lets it fly. And that's a 9 as well. The southpaws, we say in the States, shooting from the left side. Rick van der Ven puts up the first 10 of this match. Van der Ven trying to put this one away. And he does, as he has now put it out of reach for Adrian Faber. 10 would leave him 2 points short. Posts the score of 24 points to the 28 by Rick van der Ven, and van der Ven forges ahead in this match, taking the first set and taking a 2-0 lead. As you look back this season for Rick van der Ven, bronze medal at stage one. He scored a 5-set win over Brady Ellison in Shanghai, but then went on and lost the gold medal match to Kikuchi Hideki of Japan. Actually lost to Kikuchi Hideki in the semifinals, and then went on to win the bronze medal and pick up 18 points. Scoreless in Medellin, finished 5th in Antalya after suffering a 6-4 loss to Chen Xinfu, Chinese Taipei. But he was able to accumulate 13 more points and then went to Poland. And at stage four, did a little gold mining. Picked up the gold medal with a 6-2 win over Mauro Nespoli of Italy. Those 25 points making him the number one qualifier on the World Cup Tour this summer for the World Cup Finals. And in good shape right now, leading 2-0 as Faber leads off with a 10. Faber finding the center of the target.
Selden got us the first bell.
Van der Ven coming close. Faber shooting quickly. You favor that fast pace?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, the faster you shoot, the less time there is for to get gremlins in the head.
Paralysis through analysis. Yeah. I've been there. A little bit of a flinch right before he released that shot. Don't know if it affected the shot. Bottom line is he scores 8. And Van der Ven with an excellent opportunity to take the set on this shot, which he does. So Rick Van der Ven trying to make quick work of the wild card archer from France. Adrian Faber finished 17th at stage 3 in Antalya this year. That is the only World Cup event he's been entered in. Did pretty well, 17th. Third year competing internationally. The young man who speaks English, French, and German. And I love the technology we have these days. Just amazing.
I love those little cars.
Remember the old days? You actually had to walk down there and get your arrows and walk back. And
or have somebody in these events, somebody to go and get them for
go
you.
Go and get them for
walk
you.
Forward and back. But.
Although in all fairness, we should say at most events during elimination qualification, there's a lot of walking that is done.
Indeed.
Much retrieving of arrows.
Yeah. Individuals retrieve their own arrows, as you say, during qualification and eliminations. It's only in finals that they are returned here to keep the whole thing moving.
By either somebody young who has a lot of energy and can run down there and get them, or if you have a remote control vehicle like that. Nicely done. Nicely done. Adrian Faber. Might be the crowd favorite.
8-4.
Might be in pretty good position right now. Follows up with a strong shot, which could be a 10. So here is the opportunity, the first real opportunity Adrian Faber has had to take a set. And he does. Much to the delight of the hometown crowd. It will not be a clean sweep for Rick Van der Ven.
6-9.
In fact, he's feeling rather blue right now with that 6. So Adrian Faber putting up a fight, putting up 2 points, trailing now 4-2 in this match. Our final match of the recurve quarterfinals right after this match. We'll have the mixed team gold medal match, so stay with us for that. Once that's over, we'll take a short break. We'll be back at 1500 hours for the semifinals, followed by the medal matches. Here at the World Cup Finals in Switzerland. And again, that super slow motion giving us a great view of what really happens in that second or so that arrow's in flight. The trajectory, the flexibility of those arrows. And somehow, some way, from 70 meters away, you're supposed to put it right in the middle of the target. At my age, I can barely see the center of that target.
9.7 links.
Van der Ven needing to bear down right now.
Ja, goed jongen, links een X op de rand.
When he needs it, he comes through. Has a 2-point advantage. And this could be the final shot of the match and the day for Adrian Faber. as Rick van der Ven needs only 8 to win. Win and advance. 9's enough. 9 is enough. For Rick van der Ven of the Netherlands, the Dutchman, gets it done in rather short order. Not a clean sweep, but only 4 sets to defeat Adrian Faber of Switzerland. Obviously, Rick van der Ven, the prohibitive favorite coming into this match on paper, but you have to play the game, you never know.
Yeah, so Rick van der Ven really only stumbled a little in the third set, and Faber was there ready to take advantage of that. But the rest of Rick's shooting was really, really strong.
Rick van der Ven shooting a 6 in that third set. His lowest point total was 23 points in that third set, which he lost 29-23 to Adrian Faber, who can go home tell his friends that, hey, I took a set from Rick van der Ven, beat him 29-23 in the third set of our quarterfinal match. Hopefully this will be a shot in the arm for the Swiss archery teams as well.
Yeah, and great experience for Adrian. He did well out there today. And
Clementine DiGiuli yesterday did well. We also got to see Patrizio Hofer, who shot well in the mixed team match. And now we get ready for the mixed team gold medal match right here, right now on World Archery TV. They'll be going for the gold right now. Recurve mixed team competition in this format will have 4 sets, 4 arrows per set, 2 arrows per archer, 1 male, 1 female. Now 2 points are awarded to the team that wins a set, 1 point if they tie, and the first team to 5 points. Not 6 points, but 5 points determines the outcome. So let's take a look at the team from Switzerland. We're already ready to go. And there we go. On your screen on the left, Ileana Dunikin, 19 years old and unranked. So, Ileana, 19 years old and unranked, teamed up with Florian Faber, who will turn 17 next month, also unranked. And they are up against it, against a team from Mexico, which is very experienced and features Aida Roman, who's already been out here once and won her match in a thrilling shoot-off with Lisa Unruh of Germany. How much of an advantage, Hilda, to be already out here once and already know the lay of the land?
Well, given that I think the Swiss team is quite inexperienced, I think the fact that Ida's been out, she knows what it's like, she knows if there are any differences to the practice field, she'll be able to tell her teammate those, because sometimes that can happen. There's a shift one direction or another from the practice field. Here, the conditions are very still, so probably not going to play into this a lot. But if you're in another venue where there's quite a lot of wind, then you can get some variability from the practice field to the main field.
Aida Roman, bolstered by the victory that she scored this morning, feeling good, a lot of confidence, I'm sure. She's teaming up with Luis Eduardo Velez. So there's the duo from Mexico. Luis Eduardo Velez, 28 years old, ranked 42nd in the world, has been ranked as high as 22nd back in 2005. Interesting story behind Luis, which we'll get into in just a moment or so. But first, let's focus in on Aida Roman's first shot here in mixed team play. No. So now, Ileana Danico, 19 years old, unranked, and almost off the charts. Feeling those blues. Can only imagine how much adrenaline is pumping through their veins right now, these young kids out here in a World Cup final, representing their country. And while Mexico's first two shots weren't exactly right on target, they still have the lead here in the first set. Velez improves on that 8 on his first shot. Aida hoping to do the same. Roman, another 9. But a solid performance in that first set for the Mexican duo. Danico, direct hit. And Faber follows up with another direct hit. Not enough to win the set, but impressive. And gives them a confidence boost. So Mexico with a 2-0 lead after that first set, but the Swiss team working out the jitters after those opening two shots.
Absolutely, those two great shots there.
Faber on the left, Danico on the right. Neither one of them 20 years old yet, but here they are in the World Cup gold medal match. And a little bit of a fist bump right there. Getting back to Luis Eduardo Velez, his grandfather competed in the Munich Olympic Games, and then 40 years later, his grandson, Luis Eduardo, was on the team that reached the bronze medal match against South Korea in London at the Summer Games of 2012 in London. Now, did you have a front row seat there, Hilda, or you were busy probably? I imagine running around quite a bit.
Yeah, it was front row, but it wasn't exactly a seat.
You got to see some great matches.
I got to see lots of great matches. And like here, quite a number of those went to shoot-offs.
During the next break between sets, I want to find out which match is the one that stays with you the longest. Hold that thought. Danico. Sees it drift up high. And Faber's drifts low to the right. Don't see the wind picking up necessarily. So it's not a wind-related issue. Mexico, the 2-point edge. That clock rolling. Switzerland with about 30 seconds to get these last two shots off. And Danico doesn't want to leave her partner with very little time. He'll have about 15 seconds when he gets up to the shooting line. So not all the time in the world. Some people do perform better under the gun, though. And with about 4 seconds left on the clock, Faber lets it fly. and scores 8 more points for Switzerland. Velez improving on his first shot of the set.
20.
And Aida with plenty of time. Exhales, draws it back, drills it. Aida Roman trying to pick up the medal here. She'll be in the semifinals this afternoon, vying for more hardware here at the World Cup Finals. Hilda Gibson of Great Britain joining us here on World Archery TV today. Let's go back to what we were talking about a moment ago, Hilda. Lord's Cricket and the 2012 Summer Olympic Games. What's the greatest memory you took away from that event?
I think it would be the men's team final. That was Italy and the US. And just that was a really, really close match, and you couldn't call it. And it was a very, very good match.
Went down to that final shot.
Absolutely, yeah.
And decided, and the Italians able to come away with a one-point victory, although Team USA, I think, very proud of their silver medal performance. They had beaten Korea to get to that gold medal match, and so that was a great accomplishment in and of itself.
It was, and I think that because of that, going into that match, most people would have put their money on the US rather than the Italians, but the Italians held in there and then came back.
Right now, Switzerland dreaming of a comeback against Mexico. Mexico leading it 4-2-0 on set points. Aida Roman, Eduardo Velez, and Switzerland to shoot first, and they're out parking in the suburbs again. Kind of like a coach I know who says to his athletes, when you go to the shopping mall, where do you want to park? Do you want to park near the front door of the mall, or do you want to park way out there and have to walk that distance? And the smart ones say, I want to park near the front door, yes. You don't want to be parking in the suburbs. In the red zone. Very composed Aida Roman. Full draw.
Yeah.
There's the release. There's the splashdown right in the center ring. Shooting with a great deal of confidence. Aida Roman. Now back to Donico, who finished 33rd at the European Outdoor Championships in Armenia. And was 57th at stage 4 in Wrocław, Poland this year. Mexico leading 4-0 in the match, trying to make it a clean sweep in 3 straight sets, and they can do that on this shot from Aida Roman. The silver medalist from the London Olympic Games. And she finishes it off. It is all over. And in very workmanlike style, Mexico takes care of business. And it's a gold medal for Mexico. Aida Roman and Luis Eduardo Velez teaming up to win the mixed team gold medal against the wild card team from Switzerland. Two youngsters. Well, I'm sure we'll long remember this day and this match. They didn't come away with a victory, they will come away with a silver medal. And they'll come away, I think, even more, Hilda, with memories.
With memories and experience. So the next time they go into a World Cup match, you know, when they're in their elimination matches, they'll have that experience behind them. So they've done something that, you know, is one step up. That helps when they're going to those elimination matches, and who knows, they may make it to a finals at some point.
And there is no substitute for experience. You can have all the talent in the world, but if you haven't been there before, that talent may not get you through.
It may not, but, you know.
It's nice to have, though.
You need the talent. I mean, they equip themselves well. Mm-hmm. They shot against the top team, the top mixed team in the world this year, and, you know, they came away, on the downside, but they were shooting against the best in the world. They equipped themselves well, and they've gone away with some really good experience.
Sure, and put up some good shots that they'll feel good about.
Yeah.
It's almost like my golf game. If I have one good shot during the entire round, I'm ready to go back for more.
And that's archery. You shoot the good shot, sweet shot, goes right in the middle of the 10. That's why you do it, and then you keep on going and going to do that again.
I'll go back tomorrow. I'm sure I can do that again tomorrow.
Yep.
Yeah, they're not all going to be that way, but it's those good shots that bring you back, and hopefully that'll be the case for Florian Faber and Ileana Donico of Switzerland as they fall in three straight sets, 6-0. Not surprising. Mexico, obviously very good this year, and they proved that throughout the World Cup season, which started back in April. We're now in September, and they've proven it from month to month to month, from stage to stage to stage. And Aida Roman, as long as she's been around and as much as she's experienced, she still has that enthusiasm and the love for the sport.
Yeah, she's got a fantastic smile, and she always looks so happy. It's a great advert for the sport.
Enjoying a golden moment here in Switzerland with her teammate, Luis Eduardo Velez. Mexico, good as gold here on this Sunday. As we get set for the presentation of the medals to the two teams here in mixed team competition, we'll have more medal presentations coming up this afternoon. Of course, we'll have the recurve semifinals, which will be immediately followed by the bronze and gold medal matches. Saw some great matches yesterday in compound competition. Our congratulations to everybody who medaled, particularly the gold medalists. Sarah Lopez winning the gold medal in women's compound with a brilliant performance against Erica Jones, who put up a heck of a fight.
Yeah, both of those girls have been doing so well. That was a really, really sharp match.
It was an amazing day of matches, really. And then on the men's side, how about Bridger Deaton and the performance that he put on? Comes up, beats Rio Wild, gets into the gold medal match up against Pierre-Julien Deloche. She's ranked number one in the world. And I think it was his first 11 shots that were all 10s.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. And the crowd sighed when he didn't get the next one, and it almost becomes expected. But the quality of the shooting is just so high.
Remarkable shooting. Sarah Lopez, 19 years old. Bridger Deaton, 20 years old.
But both of yesterday's winners were actually the youngest in the finals. So of the eight that came in, they were both the youngest.
I think it bodes well, Hilda, for the sport, because you've got such tremendous athletes at that age, and they're going to have long careers. So we're going to have a lot of fun watching them for the next 10, 15, maybe 20, 25 years.
Absolutely. Although we've seen with the young Brazilian lad this morning that, you know, there's even younger ones coming through.
That's right. So Marcos de Almeida, whom we shall see more of coming up this afternoon in the semifinals, as Marcos de Almeida scored a clean sweep over Jake Kaminsky in the first men's recurve match of the day. Then it was Florian Kalund defeating Pierre Plion 6-4. Brady Ellison, perhaps the most exciting match on the men's side today here in the quarterfinals. Brady Ellison coming back from a 4-0 deficit to force a shoot-off and then winning it in a shoot-off. His 10 just a little bit better than the 10 put up by Eugen Yek. And Rick Vandervan cruised against Adrian Faber, winning his match 6-2. Mexico did the same, cruising in the mixed team gold medal match as Aida Roman and Luis Eduardo Velez accept their trophy.
Luis Eduardo Velez.
They are the gold medalists here at the 2014 World Cup Finals in Switzerland. They'll get their names in the newspaper, and they get to hear their national anthem. I imagine the only thing that could surpass that for these two is to be able to stand on that victory podium next year in Mexico City at the World Cup Finals and hear their national anthem played on their home turf.
Absolutely, yeah. So given their performance this year, that could be a possibility.
It could be a possibility that they'll be back again next year and they'll be back on that podium. And I have a feeling we'll see more of Ms. Danico and Mr. Faber as well on victory podiums in the future. Once again, in case you're just joining us, 2015, the World Cup Finals will be in Mexico City, which will also host the World Championships in 2017. Next year's World Championships to be held on the grounds of the Christiansborg Palace in the heart of Copenhagen. It'll be the first opportunity for individual archers and teams to start qualifying for the 2016 Olympic Games in Rio. Well, just to recap what we saw this morning in the recurve quarterfinals, the four archers to emerge on the women's side, Tatiana Segana, Cheng Ming, Aida Roman, and Zhu Jing. So two of the Chinese archers advance along with the archer from the Russian Federation, Segana, and Aida Roman from Mexico. On the men's side, Marcus de Almeida from Brazil, Florian Kalun from Germany, Brady Ellison of the United States, and Rick van der Ven of the Netherlands all survive their quarterfinal matches and get to the semifinals coming up this afternoon. Well, it is time for us to take a little bit of a break as you watch some of the highlights of this morning's action here in Lausanne, Switzerland. We will be back in just a bit. 1,500 hours to be exact with the recurve semifinals followed by the bronze and the gold medal matches. All center stage here at World Archery's 2014 World Cup Finals in Lausanne, Switzerland. For my new best friend from Great Britain, Hilda Gibson, I am Carl Arkey saying so long for just a little while. We'll see you again soon for more live coverage on World Archery TV.